So I just had a thought, and that was letting the land rest. You know, we didn't plant this year because we believed in what the Word of God said about letting the land rest. And for a couple of reasons, because land is creation, the earth is created and does creation, and therefore it needs to have its Shabbat as well. But also, I was thinking for mankind, because mankind is the only one of creation who has such a difficult time relying upon the Lord. But we were also the ones that were given free will. But so that we have that year that we are to rely on the Lord, that we don't have that planting season, that it's going to have to be the Lord providing for us. But when you look back in the pattern is on the sixth day, you do preparation. That's why they call Friday the preparation day before the Sabbath, because you're preparing for that Sabbath. You're making your meals and preparing your chores because you're not going to be doing them on the Sabbath. And so just like with the manna that came down, you know, they collected the manna and they got twice as much manna. So when we plant on that sixth year, prior to letting the land rest, you know, we're putting that seed, that extra seed into the soil, and the Lord is giving that increase so that you have enough to provide for that following year, so that you're storing it up and you're providing for it. You have to put that work in. You've got to have that seed in order for it to increase into more. And I know Christianity, the first thing that came to my mind is Christianity is going to say, so you're saying that you have to work for your salvation. And I just want to, the very next thought that popped in my head, you know, were the 10 virgins. Five of them prepared for the groom to come because they were mass excited. They were just stoked that he was coming, and he was their goal. He was their prize. And so they made sure that they had everything that they needed, that extra seed. You know, they had all the extra oil in their lantern to be able to have it through the night. But five of them didn't, you know, five of them just were coaxing along, and they were like, yeah, you know, it's cool. He'll come and we'll get to party and we'll get to go to the wedding and everything will be fab. And then nighttime came and he didn't come because he's going to return at a time that you don't expect. It says that in the scripture, like a thief in the night. And they weren't prepared. And then they were wanting to take from the five that were prepared. You know, they were like, hey, I'm entitled and you need to share your oil with us. And those girls were like, no, you should have been prepared. And so they sent them back to town. And when they went back to town to market to get the extra oil, guess what? That's when the groom came. So, you know, I don't think that the ones that went into the wedding that had the extra oil, that were able to be a part of that wedding ceremony, did they work for their salvation? Or did they just care about their salvation so much that they prepared for it? And I think that's the key. The key is caring about our salvation. That's what they say, working out your salvation. If we have to care about it enough that we're in that word and we are learning what our Lord is expecting of us, what he's going to be looking for in his return, that we care about our salvation so much that we are making sure we have sin out of our life, because he said you can overcome it. So to say that I just live with sin is bunk. It's bogus. It's crap. It's a lie. We can overcome it. If you can overcome something, why then would you keep it in your life? It's like telling a meth addict, you know, you can overcome drugs, but it's cool. You can still be an overcomer, but keep it in your medicine cabinet. That's a lie. So I think we need to take a look at our salvation and take a look at our spiritual health and see just how much of a priority it is in our life, and go from there.